Good morning. Welcome to our service this morning. So happy that you are here. This is what we traditionally call Palm Sunday, as we think about Jesus' triumphal entry in Jerusalem and the crowds that line the street, waving palm branches and offering praise. May be seated.
Good morning. It's good to be back after being gone last week. Always miss our church family, and so it's good to be back with you. Next Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. We will have two services at our normal starting times. There will not be Sunday school, but there will be a fellowship time in between the two services. Life Choices is our prayer focus for this month, and Carolyn Schrage and her team lead a vital ministry to so many women of our area. Continue to lift up the people in the countries of Israel, Ukraine, and even Haiti. We've added them to our list with the situations that are going on down there. I know each of those appreciate so much your prayers. Would you bow as we open this morning? Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the opportunity to be here in your presence this morning. And Lord, we are thankful for Life Choices. Father, for the good that they do for the many women in our community, we pray your blessing on Carolyn and her team and the work and serving of the Joplin area. We lift up the situation in Haiti, and Father, many of our missionaries and the Christian people there. We also lift up the people, continue to lift the people in Ukraine and in Israel. Father, we pray for Mark as he leads us in the study of your word this morning. Open our hearts and our minds that we would learn from the truth of your word. Be with us this morning. May all that we do be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
John saw a city that could not be hid. John saw the city, oh yes he did. John caught a glimpse of the golden throne. Tell me all about it, John. Go right on around the throne. He saw the crystal sea. There's got to be more. What will it be? I want to go to that city he saw, New Jerusalem. Jerusalem, I want to walk the streets that are golden. And I want to run where the angels that trod. City of God. John saw the lion lay down with the lamb.
I want to know everything about that lamb.
John saw the day but did not see night.
The Lamb of God,
well, he must be the light. John saw the saints worship the great I Am,
crying, worthy, worthy is the Lamb.
I want to go to that city he saw, New Jerusalem.
Your streets that are golden.
Gets you excited for that city of God, the goal of all of us as Christians. I want to continue our service reading a scripture from the Psalms, which recreates the same scene almost word for word as when Jesus entered the city on the donkey on what we call Palm Sunday. And this is a word from Psalms 118, beginning with verse 26. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. With boughs in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. We continue our service giving thanks and praise to the Lord for his love, for his goodness, for his power, and for the gift of his Son.
Crown him with many crowns. I'm
Every Lord's Day, we recognize that we crown him Lord of all. We recognize what he's done for us in giving his life for us. We're going to come to this time in our Lord, in our service where we share together in the Lord's Supper. This is Jesus' table, and Jesus invites all Christians to share in this way of remembering him. And so we unite, and if you're visiting with us, again, all Christians are welcome here as we partake. Be a little different this morning in that the choir is going to bring our communion special. We're going to be singing the song, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Then we'll have a time of meditation and prayer and partake in the Lord's Supper together.
The ministry of Jesus is recorded in John's Gospel, a recurring theme takes place. Over and over again, dealing with certain situations, our Lord declared an interesting phrase, "My hour has not yet come." In John 2, when Jesus was attending a wedding feast at Cana of Galilee, you remember the story, the provisions ran out, the wine was gone. How embarrassing. And Jesus' mother was there along with Jesus, and she came up to Jesus and seemed to want a miracle and asked Jesus to do something to resolve the problem. And you remember Jesus' response? He said, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." In John 7, Jesus was teaching in Jerusalem, And people began to say, "Can this be the Christ?" And because of that, the authorities wanted to arrest him. But John records that no one laid a hand on him because his hour had not yet come. In John 8, Jesus was again teaching in Jerusalem, giving the light of the world discourse. And in that discourse, he alluded to his own divinity. And once again, the authorities sought to arrest him. And John records no one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. But in John 12, it's now Palm Sunday. Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and people took branches from palm trees, waved them around in the air, and shouted, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." Quite a spectacle. Even the Pharisees looked at it all and said, "Look, the whole world has gone after him." And this noisy procession wound its way through the streets of Jerusalem and ended on the Temple Mount as Jesus entered the outer court of the Gentiles. And in the midst of all this, John records a dramatic turning point in the gospel narrative. Always before, it had been, "The hour has not yet come." But now, in John 12:23, Jesus says, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." And then Jesus began to plainly teach about his death. Listen to verse 27 of chapter 12 of John. "Now," not yet, "but now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." And then in verse 31, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself." And he said this to show what kind of death it was that he would die. Wow. I could preach a whole sermon on this, but I won't. But in Jesus' remarks, four distinct truths stand out. Truth number one: the very purpose for Jesus coming into the world was to die. And not just to cease breathing, but the purpose of his death, that all of the sins and ugliness and evil that all of us have done and thought and planned was laid upon Christ when he died on the cross. And Jesus' death was the perfect substitution for our sins. Truth two: in the death of Christ, that substitutionary death of Christ, God's name is glorified in the world. Because in Christ's substitutionary death, God is just, the punisher of sin, because sin must be punished. And yet God is merciful. He is the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. And so in Christ's death, the mercy and the justice of God is completely displayed for all the world to see. And in this, God's name is glorified. Truth number three: in the death of Christ, the power of Satan is broken. And the curse that was once laid upon all of us was satisfied in the death of Christ. And we, through faith in him, have been freed from our sins. And the gospel has a theological word for that. It's good news. Good news. And finally, number four, through his death, Jesus said, and the telling of the story of his death down through the centuries of time, through his death, Jesus himself will draw all men to himself. And it is to remember this death that we partake of the Lord's Supper. And so on this Palm Sunday, as we gather around the Lord's table, we remember that for Jesus, the hour had come. Jesus had fulfilled his ministry in his death. God's name was glorified. Sin's power over us is broken, and through the gospel of Christ, Jesus is even now, drawing all men to himself. Guilty, vile, and helpless, we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement? Can it be? Hallelujah. What a Savior. Gracious God in heaven, we're thankful that when the hour came, you stepped up to the plate and did for us what no one else could do. Help us remember this today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, thank you for the power of your message through the words of our songs that we sang today. May you be glorified by the words of the lips of all those who shared in that. And I thank you for the power of your message in the communion meditation from Brother Terry. I pray that you might be glorified through the words that he shared with us. And right now, I just pray that you would be speaking through Mark, the power of your word, that we might have ears willing to hear and hearts willing to change, so that we can glorify you in all we say and do. In Jesus' name, amen.
I enjoy March Madness, but as far as I'm concerned, this worship service today and the one at 8:15 was the greatest ticket in town today. How many of you are looking forward to walking in the New Jerusalem on those streets of gold someday? Thank you, choir. And maybe you knew this, maybe you did not. If you looked at the slide while the choir was singing the song around our communion time, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," it was arranged by a fellow who used to be a member of this church. And he lived right over here in the house that is in between the two that the church owns now. And Don Whitman arranged that arrangement of "When I Survey," and I can hardly get through that without tearing up. So thank you, choir, for so rich of a time. Thank you, Terry, for the good communion word today. In the first service, Chuck Hurley gave the communion meditation. It just made me higher than a kite today. We'll get out by about 3, I promise you. But wow. Hey, you would recognize the name Corrie ten Boom, right? Of course. She was a daughter of a Dutch watchmaker, and she was a Nazi concentration camp survivor. She was a dynamic Christian witness. She passed away in 1983. But during her latter years, where living in the States, she was given an honorary degree. And after the ceremony, there was a press conference. And during the press conference, one of the questions was, "Boy, how do you stay humble with such acclaim that you receive?" And Corrie ten Boom said, "Young man, do you think for a moment that on Palm Sunday, when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on that donkey, and everybody was waving palm branches and putting down their garments, and the people were singing praises, do you think for one moment the donkey thought that was for him?" And then the great Christian witness said, "If I can just be a donkey on which Jesus rides, I will bring him glory and honor and praise." She had it right, didn't she? Welcome to Palm Sunday at Park Plaza Christian Church. But today, to make sure we're in the right spot for next week and the conclusion of this series of messages on the table fellowship scenes of Luke, we're going to blast right past the triumphal entry. And we're going to blast right past the cursing of the fig tree. And we're going to blast right past the cleansing of the temple. And we're going to blast right past that question of authority. By whose authority do you do these things? We're going to blast past the parables. Jesus said he wasn't going to tell, but then he kind of did tell through the parables. And we're going to blast past that day of questions, the day we know more about in Jesus' life than any other single day. It's Tuesday of the final week. We're going to blast past the discourses. I think the one to the Pharisees in Matthew 23 was given on the teaching steps on the south side of the Jerusalem temple. I can't prove that, but I think that's the case. We're going to blast right past the Olivet Discourse, which was a huge discourse predicting the destruction of Jerusalem, which took place 40 years later, and then also he made predictions about the second coming. We're going to blast right past the events of Thursday that were so significant, where Jesus meets with his disciples in the upper room. As we mentioned and emphasized last week, he instituted the Lord's Supper on the occasion of the Passover meal and the Last Supper. All of the discourses that went on there, the foot washing that went on there, the things he taught his disciples, and then they made their exit to Gethsemane. You know what happened in Gethsemane. There was a prayer meeting there that only Jesus attended, even though the disciples were there sleeping. They came to arrest him there. They took him to Caiaphas's house, six trials, Annas, Caiaphas, Sanhedrin, Pilate, Herod, Pilate. Six trials. And then very early in the morning, they took him before the Romans got into their day very far to have him condemned. And we're going to blast right past the condemnation. We're going to blast right past the scourging and the flogging. We're going to blast right past the crucifixion itself. And we are going to come to the resurrection. Oh, I've got more to say about that next Sunday. But we're going to blast to that resurrection scene. And we come to Luke 24, and there are two table fellowship scenes. I'm calling this one this week, Bible or Bread and Bible. And next week, Fish and Forgiveness. Bread and Bible and Fish and Forgiveness. Now, when we come to Luke 24, beginning with verse 13, we see this passage. In fact, I like how Warren Wiersbe has it. He says it's kind of like this when you get to the 24th chapter. Open tomb, open heart, open mind. He's got it right. Open tomb, the women came to anoint the body. They didn't get it all done before 6 o'clock on Friday. And so they came to anoint the body. Jesus wasn't there. They had a vision of angels. And the angels said, he's not here, he's risen from the dead. They went back and reported to the apostles. And according to Luke, the apostles thought it was an idle tale. Huh. But we do read that Peter ran to the tomb, saw the clothes of the graves, and left. Now, John tells us he was there too. In fact, he tells us twice he outran Peter. But anyway, that's where we pick up the story. And I'd like to carve our passage into two parts today. The first one is schooling Jesus. You ever tried that? I think I'll just set Jesus straight. I'll just tell Jesus about Jesus. How's that? I'll just tell him how he should have done it. Schooling Jesus. And then we'll take a turn and we'll talk about being schooled by Jesus. That's the better posture, let me tell you. So if you have your Bibles or your devices, let's look at this first section, schooling Jesus. It begins in verse 13 of Luke chapter 24, and this is what we read. That very day, yeah, it's the resurrection day. It's the evening of that day. So this will be a table fellowship scene. That very day, two of them, we don't know the name of one. We know the name in a minute or two here of the other. Two of them were going to a village named Emmaus. The scholars have located four different places where they think this little village might be. I'll show you a few pictures where it might be. About 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. Boy, it must have been quite a talk, don't you think? And while they were talking, and that's not the normal word for talking, it's the Greek word homologeo, from which we get the English word homiletics. It means to speak the same thing. A preacher wants to speak the same thing as the biblical text. But when you're talking with somebody, you're speaking the same thing about all these things that had happened in Jerusalem. They were just talking and talking and talking. One morning, the last thing I do when I go to the YMCA to kind of cool down is I just walk a mile. And one day, the lady in front of me there on the little track had a thing on her back, on her shirt that said, "No coffee, no talkie." Well, I don't know if these guys had their coffee, but they were talking and discussing together. And as they did, Jesus drew near and went with them. Here's the funny thing. They didn't know it was Jesus. just like Mary Magdalene in the garden. Didn't know. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. The word is epignosko. Their eyes were kept from knowing him. And this is what the scholars call the divine passive. It's like God kind of held his hand over their eyes by his sovereignty, at least momentarily. And he said to them, Jesus that is, what is this conversation? Actually, it's the Greek word logos. What's this word you've been talking about, holding on with each other as you walk? And they stood still, looking sad. Actually, it's stronger than that in Greek. It means stern, or it means grim. Then one of them named Cleopas. Now, some scholars think that this is the same name, a different spelling, as the name Clopas, which appears in John 19. If that's true, the other person probably is Mary, one of the Marys in the Bible. So could this be a husband and wife team, the wife sharing in the Christian witness? I don't know if that's the case. It says Cleopas answered him, "Are you the only visitor," literally means stranger, "to Jerusalem, who doesn't know that the things that have happened there in these days?" So they're accusing Jesus of not being very socially aware. Jesus is just out to lunch. He's obviously culturally unaware of what's going on. And he said to them, "What things? Has Jesus ever played naive with you?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed, ergon, work, and word, logos, before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him." And then comes this phrase, "But we had hoped." That's the saddest phrase in the text today. "But we had hoped." Now listen to me. You can say that during Holy Week. You can say that on Palm Sunday. You can say that on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. You can say, "But we had hoped." But don't you dare walk in this building next week and say that. Because that resurrection and empty tomb is all about hope. By the time you get to Friday, it's all about love. "But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." Yes, besides all this, it's now the third day. Oh boy. So many third day stories in your Bible since these things have happened. "Moreover, some of the women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they didn't see him." This strange visitor who walks alongside of them plays naive, and they try to school him a little bit. There are, roughly speaking, 12 or so, depending on how you count, resurrection accounts. Because Jesus doesn't want you to kiss your brains goodbye. He wants you to have an informed faith. And the collaborative eyewitness testimony of the resurrection is powerful. And so they come across this Jesus character, and he plays naive and says, "What things?" And they begin to school Jesus. "Well, don't you know? Are you the only visitor that doesn't know this information? The fact of the matter is, all of this stuff took place, and we're rather sad about it because we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." Like I said, you can say that this week. You can't say that this Friday. In fact, by the time we get to Friday and on into Sunday, we probably need to think of another passage. Instead of "we had hoped," we need to think of Paul's message to King Agrippa in Acts 26, verse 8, when he says, "Why does it seem incredible to you that God would raise the dead?" That's what we'll need next week. But have you ever tried to school Jesus? You know, we got people out there in the world that try to school Jesus. They try to tell Jesus about Jesus. They try to tell him how he should have done things. They try to give him advice. I would have to insert at this point a little bit of northern humor. If you were raised in the 50s and 60s and 70s in the northern plains, this will make sense. But Miss Carl and I, I've told you before, are kind of avid fans of the rather liberal storyteller from St. Paul named Garrison Keillor. And he had this two-hour radio program on Saturday nights from 5 to 7 called Prairie Home Companion. And he tells a story about an engineer who did something really wrong and was sentenced to die at the guillotine. It's obviously a made-up story. But this fella is blindfolded. He's put down on the guillotine, and they pulled the lanyard, and nothing happened. They pulled it again, and nothing happened. They pulled it again, and nothing happened. Finally, they thought this is going nowhere, so they decided to remove the sentence of death and just make him go to prison for life. They removed his blindfold. He was an engineer. He looked up at the guillotine and said, "Anybody got a pair of pliers? I think I can fix this." That's what will happen to you if you try to school Jesus. You'll end up fixing your own death sentence. He went on to say this statement. I kind of like this. Garrison Keillor said, "I'm quite comfortable speaking at church school. I'm a Christian myself. I do believe the Son of God came to this planet, the co-creator of the solar system and infinite more solar systems and constellations billions of light years away. And when you get your arms around the idea that God Almighty loves you personally, not just in theory, then you've achieved something remarkable. But I'm not preachy about this. I've spoken to Jewish groups, and some of my best friends are Unitarians. I tell them, if I'm wrong about the afterlife, no problem. I just cease to be. But if you're wrong and you face God, I'd like to see you talk your way out of that." You try to school Jesus, and that's where it'll end up. Far better to be schooled by Jesus. And that's what we read beginning in verse 25, that Jesus kind of sets them straight. Does he need to set you straight today? Let's take a look. Verse 25, "And he said to them, Oh, foolish ones." Sometimes in your Bible, when you read the word foolish, you need to think the word moron, because it actually is where we get our English word moron. That's not the case here. This is a word that actually has a little A on the front of it, which means not, and it means not wise ones, not knowing ones. Oh, not knowing ones, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. You know, I've been at this for a while now, and it's been my observation that while there are legitimate intellectual objections to faith, and they need to be handled, and they need to be dealt with, there are intellectual objections to faith. But most of my time through the years, I haven't found them to be intellectual at all. I've found them to be matters of the heart. Somebody is slow of heart. It's not the evidence, because the evidence is there. It's more slowness of heart that's the problem. He rebukes them for having slow of heart to believe. And then verse 26, "Was it not necessary?" That little word in Greek is, it is of divine necessity. How could you miss this? That the Christ should suffer these things. That's the hardest thing for the ancients to get their arms around, and it's the hardest thing for us to get our arms around. I thought the Messiah was a conquering hero. He will be someday. But his way in the week of Holy Week was the way of sacrifice, the way of suffering. One of the hardest things for these guys to understand is, why did the man of sorrows have to suffer? I don't get it. And that's one intellectual objection we'll have to face in the next sermon series in April and May, in dealing with, if God is good, then why all this suffering? Sure, it's a legitimate issue to deal with. But Jesus says the way of God in the world when it's fallen is the way of sacrifice and the way of suffering. And verse 27, "And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted them to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." Oh, wouldn't you love to have been a fly on the wall at that place? They're walking along, and Jesus is giving them a Bible study lesson. He is schooling them. Now, if I could just say, by Moses and prophets, Moses and prophets, that's a metonymy for the B-I-B-L-E. A little later in this text, we'll see it next week, he will add that third category, even not only Moses and the prophets, but also the writings. The point is, he has to walk them through what this looks like. And the Bible says he interpreted it for them. May I say the Greek word? You'll hear an English word in it. Dia hermeneuo. You recognize anything by the last part? Hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is the science of interpretation. And I don't know how he did this exactly, but he walks them back through probably several passages, certainly the broad sweeps of Moses and the prophets, to try to say to them, this is talking about me. and the light bulbs evidently begin to come on their heads. I don't know how he did it. Look at what he goes on to say, verse 28. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. That's Emmaus. He acted as if they were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent." So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at table with them, he took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were open and they recognized him. I suppose they saw the scars. I don't know. And he vanished from their sight. Well, that's a bummer. And they said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road and opened to us the scriptures?" Good Bible study will give you a heartburn. That's what it'll do. And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and those who were with them and gathered together, saying, "The Lord has indeed risen and has appeared to Simon." And they told what had happened on the road and how he'd walked, how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. Bible and bread come together here. And if I can, Jenny, I want to go back to Emmaus, if we can go back to those pictures. Let me show you where this took place, because this is the table fellowship scene. If you'll fix it in your mind on the map, it looks like this. Probably Emmaus, though there are four different possible locations, a little bit north, mostly west of Jerusalem. And when you go to what this city nowadays is called Nicopolis, or later on in Roman history, not called Nicopolis, you'll see the entrance to the city, the little village there. It's pretty unique. They've kind of built back part of it. You'll go to the next picture and you will see kind of the side view of that front entrance. And the third picture will show you kind of going up to a church building. One of the reasons that you might know that this might be the true site is because early on they built church buildings all over the holy sites. So could this, by historical tradition, be the spot? There's the church. It's a beautiful church building, by the way. And they even have a stage there where you can see a little lectern. If you maybe this is where they sat down and they actually Jesus began to exegete and show from the scriptures, from Moses and the prophets, where this took place. Now the Bible says there's, of course, you know, there's some, I should tell you, there's some Christian tombs in the area, some tombs of Christians in this area. But go to this other slide, if you will. See, the other person is actually Larry Daniel. That's the thing. You didn't know Cleopas. We got Cleopas and Jesus and Larry. That's who it is. So Larry's there. But this became the occasion where bread and Bible kind of came together, if you will. And yes, they would have seen the scars perhaps, but maybe more to the point, they saw some connections they hadn't seen before. I don't know what Jesus did with this. I kind of think he maybe walked down through some stuff. Maybe he started with what some scholars call the first word of evangelism in the Bible, Genesis 3:15. Other people think that's not the first gospel message. Larry Pachar thinks one way. John Kerr, these are Old Testament guys. They think of it, he thinks of it another way. That's all right. But maybe he gets to Genesis 12:3 and that through Abraham's family, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Maybe he gets to Genesis 22, and he talks about God saying to Abraham, "Take your son, your only begotten son, and give him back to me on the mountain of provision." Maybe he would go to Exodus 12 and talk about the Passover. Maybe he went to Numbers 24 and talked about the star that would be in the sky. Maybe he went to Deuteronomy 18, that God will raise up for you a prophet like unto me, says Moses. Maybe he went to 2 Samuel 7 and talked about King David. Maybe he went to Psalm 2, "Why do the nations rage?" Maybe he went to Psalm 16, "You will not allow your Holy One to see decay." Maybe he goes to Psalm 22, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Maybe he goes to Psalm 69, "Zeal for thy house will consume me." Maybe he goes to Psalm 110, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand and make your enemies a footstool for your feet, and you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." Maybe he goes to Psalm 118, "The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone." Maybe he went to Isaiah 52, verse 13, all the way to 53, verse 12, "A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief." Maybe he went to Jeremiah 23 and Ezekiel 34, that the Lord will raise up a true shepherd of Israel. Maybe he went to Daniel 7, where this Son of Man participates with the Ancient of Days in redeeming the universe. Maybe he went to Haggai chapter 2, the desire of nations would come. Maybe Zechariah 9, where this person would ride in on that city on that donkey. Maybe Malachi 3, where a messenger would be sent. And the closing words of your Old Testament are, "And that messenger will turn the hearts of the children to their fathers, and the hearts of the fathers to their children." I don't know what this lesson would have been like, but it must have been quite a lesson. Matt Proctor calls it the best sermon I never heard, because we weren't there. But it would have been wonderful to walk through all those passages in the Old Testament and seen the connecting of the dots between Jesus' life and what that testament actually says. A scientist by the name of Sir Michael Faraday was coming to the end of his road in life, and it just so happened that a journalist questioned him about what speculations he had about life and death, and he responded, "Speculations? I know nothing of speculations. I only know of certainties. I know that my Redeemer lives, and because he lives, I shall live also." If you want to school Jesus, I guarantee it won't work out very good. But if you want to be schooled by Jesus, the light bulb will come on above your head, and you'll find that the Bible and the bread that he broke and gave to them, and probably it wasn't communion they were thinking of, like we emphasized so strongly last week, probably it was feeding to the 5,000, feeding to the 4,000, somewhere where they would have recognized something he had done previously. But bread and Bible really came together for heart and for eyes. This text is really not so much about bread and Bible as it's about your heart. So let me ask you on Palm Sunday, how's your heart? And is it clean enough to where God can open your eyes? I think what's going on in this text more than anything else, and we'll see more of its emphasis next week, is this, that believing hearts lead to open eyes. Believing hearts lead to open eyes. Miss Carl and I got back last night about 10 o'clock from close to the Indiana border. We were there for the funeral service of a guy by the name of Pete Mitchell. Pete's wife, Pat, died 14 years ago at age 78. Pete and Pat Mitchell were a Southern gospel singing family. I do not know how many revivals we had done together. I just quit keeping track. But we've been close to this family since the fall of 1978. Pete Mitchell was a florist, okay? And he did a casket piece after casket piece after casket piece. I know I'm biased, but I thought he was the best at his craft. And it wasn't just a job for him. He was doing casket pieces to help a grieving family. Pete was on the board of St. Louis Christian College for years. For 16 years, he was on the board at Good News Productions International right here in Joplin, Missouri. And I can never go on the campus of Good News Productions without thinking of Pete Mitchell from Robinson, Illinois. If you like Heath candy bars and Marathon oil, that's Robinson, Illinois. That's what that little county seat town is known for. And there in the church where Pete and Pat Mitchell were charter members, Pete labored for the Lord. And his family is known far and wide. Pete and Pat hosted missionaries in their home. One of the testimonies in the service before I got up to preach was from a gal named Lucy Jensen, whose former name was Lucy Yangmei. If that sounds a little familiar to a missionary name and the J. Russell Family Morris name and Joel Kopong and Jesse and Lisa from Park Plaza, then you got it. It's the right family. And Lucy got up and gave a wonderful testimony of how they'd received them so well. But Pete Mitchell had a marvelous heart. His heart was so clean. He was just a magnificent person. And just, he was a man of steel when it came to convictions. He was a man of velvet when it came to kindness. That family raised purebred Cocker Spaniels. He wouldn't give you a dime for the whole lot of them, Pete wouldn't. But Pat thought they were special. I remember one time when I kind of broke down in a weak moment. She said, "Mark, those girls need a puppy." I said, "They do not need a puppy." And Pete was in back of Pat saying, "They need a puppy." He was going like that. "Don't take the puppy." We had a weak moment and Pepper came home with us. Most expensive free dog I ever got in my life. Gee whiz. But that was the Pete Mitchell family. We had Pete's funeral yesterday. Max and Marta and Mont, Mark, and all their families were there. It was a wonderful celebration. But the thing I can tell you about Pete Mitchell is this. He and his daddy started that florist business on Good Friday back in 1947. I can tell you, though, that it was his heart. It was his heart that you were drawn to. Selfless, kind, man of steel, man of velvet. If you know anything about Good Friday and the love of God, if you know anything about the hope we have in the resurrection, then hopefully you would embrace the idea that it's your heart and your eyes and your mind that needs to be connected with Him. The song that Cindy is playing is, of course, has the lyrics, "Open my eyes, illumine me." It was written by Clara Scott. No relation, best as I know. She was born in Illinois. She died in Iowa. There was a horse and buggy accident in Dubuque, and she died. She only lived into her 50s, but she was the very first woman to ever publish a book of hymns. And one of them was this. She ran a seminary in Lyons, Iowa, for girls to study. And open my eyes that I may see wonderful glimpses of truth. That's what He has for us. Maybe that's what you need today on this Palm Sunday. I hope that this week you'll think of what Jesus did on Monday, what He did on Tuesday, what He did on Wednesday, what He did on Thursday. And that all through the week, so that when we meet together on Good Friday, your heart will be full of what He has for you. If you have a public decision for Christ today, either about His church or to have your heart open and your mind, then we'll urge you to make it as we stand right now as a congregation and sing our time of decision.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth Thou hast for me. Place in my hand the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for Thee. Reign, my God, I will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me. Spirit divine, open my ears and I may hear voices of truth.
Everybody, will you be seated for just a minute while I make an introduction and in a formal way. This is Terry Chilton. He's been coming to our services for some time now and got it hooked up with Morris and Nancy Rands over here, often sits by them. They're friends. And so we're just really glad that he has come as an immersed believer in Jesus Christ today to transfer his fellowship into the church. I want to tell you a couple things. First of all, Terry is married and his wife is very invested, very involved in another church. And so they've talked about this. She's been here for Christmas at the Plaza and all. We got a chance to greet her. But she's very involved. But Terry just came and he began to come to Wednesday night study and Bible school and other things. And he just kind of fell in love with y'all, with Park Plaza. And so they have talked about it as a married couple. And his wife is very fine with him coming here and hooking up with us at Park Plaza. So we're glad about that. And we'll tug on her just a little bit, but not in any kind of way. We're glad she's finding a place of service for the Lord. But anyway, I want to tell you now that Terry's truck driver, drove for years for Walmart and all, but, and he's okay with me telling you this, would like me to tell you this, and that is, oh, within this last year, I forget exactly when,
May,
he had a stroke, pretty significant one, actually. In fact, he's still doing therapy on the hand that he's working on, and so when you speak to Terry, you might find that a word or two, he wanted me to tell you this so that you wouldn't be taken by surprise by it, but sometimes words come a little hard. at times, but he's very bright and he knows the Lord. And so I want you to know about that, that he is married. I want you to know about his stroke that he had. He's getting better, making progress, but it's been kind of slow. But since May, I think he's doing pretty good to get up here up front and everything. And so, as I mentioned to Terry, the basis of our fellowship with one another is Jesus Christ. And so by belief, I would ask you this simple question. Do you, Terry Chilton, still believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God?
I do.
God bless you. We're so glad to have you. Will you welcome Terry Chilton into our church family just now? Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. Also, want to remind you about our Good Friday service. Folks, you can't have a resurrection if nobody died. So we want to celebrate the love of God in Christ for us about his death on the cross. It'll be a briefer service. It'll be kind of a subdued service. It will kind of, the solemnity of it will be important for us to capture the mood of that. Conrad Proctor, and he's going to be preaching Friday night. I'm going to close this out with a communion meditation, and we'll close the service. It'll be a briefer service, less than an hour, but at 6 o'clock Friday night, really want to invite you back. In the event that that doesn't work for you or your family plans, we will be live streaming that service. So if you're around the internet at 6 o'clock Friday night, that will work as well. Let's stand. If you are visiting with us today, a guest with us, we'd love for you to visit our welcome table on this Palm Sunday. Hope you will have a great week. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you. The Lord Jesus can be the best Bible teacher there ever was. And can from Moses and the prophets and even the writings tell us about himself. Lord, we want to be good Bible students, but at the end of the day, we really want our hearts and our eyes, our minds to be enlivened by you. Thank you for Terry and coming today and joining our fellowship. Thank you for this Holy Week. Help us to think about what that means as we come to Resurrection Sunday. If you, Terry, you're coming. And if you decide to come this week, it'll be just fine with us. So dismiss us with your blessing, we pray, and all the church said, amen.
There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power in the name of the Lord. There is hope in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he in the name of the Lord.